Hey, what's up, everybody? Gonna do a classic rock reaction, man. This is a complimentary quad, and it's featuring the music of Free, the band Free that Paul Rogers was in. And the songs we're gonna look at is All Right Now, and that's gonna be a live one from the Isle of Wight, followed by Free Child, followed by Wishing Well, and then finally Ride on a Pony. And that's them, it's an official live video from 1970. It doesn't say where they were performing this live. So looking forward to it, man. I haven't done a lot of Free on this channel. I think maybe two at the most. So it'll be really cool to check it out, and especially some of their live stuff. So before I pop this off, man, just want to give a shout out and a thanks to Jeff. Thanks for the recommendation and the links, man. Jeff says, hi Wayne, for my next recommendation, I thought I'd suggest Free. I'm not sure if you've ever heard you do a reaction to this group before. Free did rock and blues in the 60s and 70s, and were usually spoken in the same sentence when you speak of influences of the late 60s with Cream and the Band. The original group was only together through 73. Paul Rogers and Simon Kirk moved on from there to Bad Company. I remember when I was doing my Artist of the Month, Paul Rogers, he threatened Artist of the Month a couple of times, and I can't remember the reaction that spurred it, but I did say, some people instructed me that if he does become Artist of the Month, you got to do Free, Bad Company, and The Firm. And so I remember that about Paul Rogers. It was really interesting. So with all of that said, man, let's hit this up. The Isle of Wight Festival. Free doing All Right Now. Let's get it. That's a great shot. You can see the crowd behind it. Thank you. Nudge him to be in there. Taking part in history like that. Are they saying more?
You want them back? Okay, let's say it louder, please, for free. Thank you.
Hey, that was great, man. Damn. You know, I'm watching this video and little shots of the crowd. Some of them are clapping, some are sitting bobbing their heads, and some are standing up clapping and dancing, and some are just casually walking around. It's all good, you know, because they, meaning you old cats, damn man, you guys had that shit in spades. You were so spoiled. You had no idea what you guys were enjoying back in the day, man. When was this? 1970? And you had so much in abundance. You can go to a festival like this every single weekend if you chose. You old cats had it good. I was born in the wrong era, man, let me tell you. Alright. That was awesome. Paul Rodgers, in my opinion, is one of the best rock singers ever. One of the best rock and roll voices. I love hearing this guy sing, man. And where do you put Paul on your list of great rock singers? Great rock voices. Excuse me, my sugarcane rum is working. Where do you put him? Let me know. I hold him up there in high regard. You might not think so, but I hold him high up there along the echelons of the Freddie Mercury's and the Robert Plants, you know? I think he just needed maybe more of a solid, long-running, consistent platform. The length of a Zeppelin, the length of a Who, you know, the length of a Pink Floyd, that sort of thing. And, you know, I know that a lot of you would probably say, okay, I'll put him in my top 10, that sort of thing. I put him in my top 5, man. I like him that much. And I also hear that even today, his voice hasn't changed much. He's still got his voice. He can still reach the decent notes that his songs allowed him to reach. He probably couldn't sing, let's say, a song by Queen or a song by Zeppelin or something like that reach those crazy notes. But, you know, for the songs that he's performed and his vocal style, he still got it still to today. And what would Paul be like? He would be, I think, the same age of Robert Plant. Wouldn't he be 72, I think? So, yeah, man, still got it, which is awesome. And I believe he might still be performing. So, Free. Let's do this. Let's take a look at the band real quick, and then we'll hit up some song information, man. Free. Free were an English rock band formed in London in 68, best known for their 1970 signature hit song, All Right Now. They disbanded in 73. Lead singer Paul Rogers went on to become the frontman of the more successful rock band, Bad Company, which also featured his Free bandmate Simon Kirk on drums. Lead guitarist Paul Kosoff formed Backstreet Crawler in 73, but died from a pulmonary embolism at the age of 25 in 76. Damn. Rest in peace, young man. Holy. Bassist Andy Fraser formed Sharks. Free became renowned for their live shows and non-stop touring. However, their studio albums did not sell very well until their third, Fire and Water, featured the massive hit All Right Now. The song helped secure them a place at the Isle of Wight Festival in 1970, where they played to 600,000 people. In the early 1970s, Free became one of the biggest selling British blues rock groups. By the time they disbanded, they had sold more than 20 million albums around the world and had played more than 700 arena and festival concerts. All Right Now remains an R&B staple and has been entered in ASCAP's 1 million airplay singles club. Not bad for a band that's only been around, together really, you know, as a unit for 2 years. That's really quite an accomplishment. And then went on to form the more successful Bad Company. Hey, Rolling Stone has referred to the band as British hard rock pioneers. The magazine ranked Rogers number 55 in its list of the 100 greatest singers of all time, and Paul Kosoff at number 51 in its 100 greatest guitarist of all time. Yeah, he's quite an accomplished guitarist, man. 26, man. Free were signed to Island Records in the UK and A&M Records in North America. All Right Now. All Right Now is a song by English rock band Free. It originally appeared on the 1970 album Fire and Water, with Free recorded on the Island Records label formed by Chris Blackwell. Released as the album's second single, All Right Now hit number 2 in the UK singles chart and number 4 in the US Billboard Hot 100. In July of 73, the song was re-released, reaching number 15 on the UK chart. In 91, a remix of the song was released, reaching number 8 on the UK chart. Sometimes the re-releases really do the song justice. All Right Now was a number 1 hit in over 20 territories and was recognized by ASCAP, American Society of Composers, Authors, and Publishers, in 1990 for garnering 1 million+ radio plays in the US by late 89. In 2006, the BMI London Awards included a Million Air Award for 3 million airplays of All Right Now in the USA. The song also remains as a staple of classic rock. Yeah, man. Whenever I turn on classic rock radio, I can't tell you the last time that I heard All Right Now. Isn't that sad? I can tell you the last time I heard Stairway to Heaven. I can tell you the last time I heard Bohemian Rhapsody. I can tell you the last time I heard Hotel California for the umpteenth time in a damn week. But I can't tell you the last time I heard All Right Now from Free. Isn't that some sad shit? Sad times we live in. You old cats, man. You had it good. You're the product of my envy. I'm green with that shit. Alright. According to drummer Simon Kirk, All Right Now was written by Free bassist Andy Fraser and singer Paul Rogers in the Durham Students Union Building, Dunham House. Dunelm House. He said, quote, All Right Now was created after a bad gig in Durham. We finished our show and walked off the stage to the sound of her own footsteps. Wow. The applause had died before I had even left the drum riser. It was obvious that we needed a rocker to close our shows. All of a sudden, the inspiration struck Fraser and he started bopping around singing All Right Now. He sat down and wrote it right there in the dressing room. It couldn't have taken more than 10 minutes. Fraser has agreed, largely, with this history. Wow, okay. It's amazing just how it just hits you in the face sometimes. You gotta go with it. Tune into your frequency, your wisdom, your intuition. All right. Some of the best songs come by way of intuition. Let's hit up our next track, that being Child. All right, man. So, this is Child by Free. Let's get it.
Mind. Oh, like a river aside the dust and grows as it flows. The feeling deep inside of you must break like a dam. It so set you free. So set you. So set you free.
Also, bass Andy Furzer from Simon Kirk. Nice picks, nice compilation picks. Excellent tune. Child by Free. Yeah, they are definitely showing that they've got some good range and some diversity in their song structure and their playing. They can speed it up, they can go hard, they can slow it down, they can go bluesy, they can go raw. Really, really good mixture of variety of things that they can offer. So, Child appears on Free at Last. It's the fifth studio album by English rock band Free. It was recorded between January and March of 72 and released in May that year. After breaking up in April of 71, due to differences between singer Paul Rogers and bassist Andy Furzer, the band had reformed in January of 71. What were those differences? Do you guys know? It's not saying here. Recording. All members of the band made a concerted effort to work smoothly and efficiently for guitarist Paul Kossoff's sake, as he was suffering due to an addiction to mandrax, or quaaludes. For example, in a symbolic gesture, all tracks were credited to every member of the band, regardless of who actually wrote them. The attitude to the songwriting was also vastly different. There are no outright rock songs at all, and the three songs that contain fast-paced moments all have slower, more introspective moments. Also, many fans have interpreted some of the melancholic lyrics, many of which concern people in some form of emotional distress, as referring to Kossoff. Reception. The album was reasonably successful, peaking at number 9 in the UK Albums Chart, making it their most successful UK studio album since Fire and Water in 1970. The single release, Little Bit of Love, reached number 13, despite failing to enter the top 10. It was their third best-selling single release at the time. It would be beaten by Wishing Well the following year. However, problems began again when the band was then expected to tour to promote the album, as Kossoff was faced with a task for which he was not physically capable. Gigs had been disastrous, with Furzer remembering that you could see people in the audience crying for him, longing for him to be all right, quoted in Paul Sutcliffe's liner notes. Unable to continue, Furzer left the band permanently, aged just 20. Kossoff also pulled out of the tour, although not technically leaving the band, in order to seek treatment for his drug addictions. During the period in late 71, where the band had split, Kossoff and Kirk had formed a new band with Japanese bassist Tetsu Yamauchi and keyboard player John Rabbit Bundrick. Kirk asked them to join the free tour in place of Frazier. They accepted and joined the band officially. Okay. Little bits of history that I didn't know there. All right. Good song, man. Great tune. So let's hit up our next track then, and that being Wishing Well. Free, Wishing Well. Let's get it. That's a restless soul, that person.
But I know what you're wishing for.
Love in a peaceful world.
Yeah.
Love in a peaceful world.
Oh, yeah.
Love in a
Good song. Powerful. Good relatable lyrics. Wishing well. I haven't heard that phrase in a good long while to describe somebody who is just never satisfied with their current life. They're always thinking the grass is greener. They always want to move around, stray around, run around, never settled. We all know people like that, man. So, Wishing Well. Wishing Well is a song by English rock band Free. It was written by the entire group about their close friend Bevan T. Woodhouse. It was released in December of 72 as a single and entered the UK singles chart on the 13th of January in 73, reaching number 7. The single was re-released in 85 and reached number 96 in the UK singles chart. The song is featured on the band's sixth and final studio album, Heartbreaker. It was their final hit single before the group disbanded in 73, with Paul Rodgers and Simon Kirk going on to form Bad Company. Matthew Greenwald of AllMusic said, quote, "Lyrically, the song can be interpreted many ways, but it appears on the surface to be an angry message to a friend with heavy substance abuse problems who has one foot in the wishing well, which is possibly an analogy for one foot in the grave." Okay. Next to All Right Now, this is indeed the band's most important and perhaps finest moment. Unquote. I always interpreted the wishing well to mean that they're always desiring something more, something better, being on the side where the grass is greener, stuff like that. Restless, always moving around, trying to get the next big thing. Album reception. The album was, by Free standards, a huge success. It became their third top 10 album in the UK, reaching number 9, and reaching number 47 in America, which was also a considerable success for the band. Also, the single release, Wishing Well, became their third most successful single, reaching number 7. It's widely regarded as one of their definitive songs. Despite the success of the album and impending tour of America, it finally became apparent that the band had passed the point of no return. Kossoff being credited as an additional musician came as a shock to the entire band. Kossoff spiraled to his lowest ebb and was unable to go to America. He was replaced for the tour by Wendell Richardson from Osibisa, against Rogers' instincts. Richardson proved, through no fault of his own, to be the wrong choice, and once the tour ended, the band finally gave up. Rogers and Kirk formed Bad Company with Mick Rouse, formerly of Mott the Hoople, and Boz Burrow, formerly of King Crimson. Yamauchi joined Faces. Excuse my damn throat. Bundrick became a session musician and eventually became a regular keyboard player with The Who. Kossoff formed his own band, Backstreet Crawler, which Bundrick joined in the later stages of the band. After one solo album by Kossoff, Backstreet Crawler, which was well received, and one Backstreet Crawler band release, The Band Plays On, and live dates in the UK in 75 and USA in 76, Kossoff regained his playing form. The guitarist sadly died of a pulmonary embolism on board a plane bound for New York on the 19th of March in 76 at the age of 25. A further Backstreet Crawler album called Second Street was released posthumously, which is also well regarded. Damn, man. Rest in peace, Kossoff. Alright, so let's hit up our last track, man. That being Ride on a Pony. Free. Ride on a Pony, and this is their 1970 official live video. Let's get it. I do, and I'm gonna see it through. Yeah.
to see it through.
So they formed in 68, and this is being shot in 1970. And so, like, you know, they're pretty chill in the crowd, they're relaxed, you know. I guess in the studio format, they had to be a little bit contained. That's what I'm guessing. Or they're just kind of like, holy shit, man, what am I witnessing here? This is so different, so new. But I'm guessing that this is, you know, the former Beatles fan girl crowd. Now they're a little bit more mature, you know, 8 years removed. They're older, wiser, and a little bit more chill. That's what I'm guessing. The crowd always intrigues me, you know, what they're doing, what they're not doing, what they should be doing. All right. Great tune. Very soulful, man. Bluesy and soulful. Good jam, they're having a good time performing. Fantastic to watch. Ride on a Pony. Excuse my damn throat, man. I drank a little bit too much coffee before I started this. Ride on a Pony. Appears on Highway. It's the fourth studio album by English rock band Free. It was recorded extremely quickly in September of 70, following the band's success at the Isle of Wight Festival, but with an attitude of relaxation, the band having achieved worldwide success with their previous album, Fire and Water, and the single, All Right Now. It's a low-key and introspective album compared with its predecessors. Interesting. Recording. From a writing point of view, Highway continued in the same vein as previous albums, with vocalist Paul Rogers and bassist Andy Fraser collaborating on 7 of the 9 songs. For the most part, it was the easiest of their albums to record, as they had achieved their desire to have a hit single and return to the studio with renewed confidence. Guitarist Paul Kossoff, however, found sudden fame more difficult to deal with and remembered the aftermath of All Right Now as being a great increase in pressure from every angle. This is quoted in Phil Sutcliffe's liner notes. He preferred the more serious, weighty songs on the album, such as Be My Friend, which he saw as an antidote to the frivolity of All Right Now. It was their last album to be recorded in a position of success and security, as its failure contributed to the emotionally insecure Kosoff's growing drug addiction and the band's temporary split, from which it never truly recovered. Some, including drummer Simon Kirk, also cite the death of Kosoff's idol Jimi Hendrix, which occurred during the sessions for this album on the 18th of September 1970, as an important factor in his eventual breakup, the band. Wow, you see how influential someone can be? Reception. Much to the band's disappointment, the album reached only number 41 in the UK albums chart. The previous album, Fire and Water, reached number 2, and it reached number 190 in the US. The single release, The Stealer, failed in the UK also, but reached number 49 in the US. Rodgers and Kirk re-recorded The Stealer with Bad Company in 75 during the sessions for the band's third album, Run with the Pack, in 76, but the track was not included on the album. Rod Stewart and The Faces also featured it regularly in their live set. An early young Rod Stewart has similar vocals to that of Paul Rodgers, don't you think? The album received a lukewarm critical reception. The single release, The Stealer, had not been Island Records boss Chris Blackwell's first choice. He had wanted to release Ride on a Pony, but this was changed at the band's insistence. Some, such as engineer Andy Johns, blamed the album cover, which was aesthetically flat compared to previous releases and did not prominently display the band's name. That shit don't matter. Look at Led Zeppelin. Look at their In Through the Outdoor. You know what I mean? It was believed by whom that some fans who otherwise would have bought the album failed to notice it because of this. One UK newspaper even reported the album as being recorded by the Highway Troupe, stating it's a good album for a party or discotheque with a touch of the Rolling Stones influence. They returned to the studio in early 71 and managed to record 4 tracks before they eventually split, after fulfilling contracted tour dates. These limbo tracks included the UK number 4 hit single, My Brother Jake. The other 3 have surfaced on various other albums over the years. A notable cover version in 71 is Be My Friend by Sylvia McNeil, produced by Tony Hall on RCA 2058, and that's the UK 45 RPMs. Okay, so that is what Wikipedia has for us about this song and the state and manner that the band was in at the time. Very, very important. And the atmospheric influences. Jimi Hendrix dying, one of their idols. Yeah, so that would definitely kind of throw you off a little bit. And when you're very, very delicate, you know, both the individuals and the band themselves, stuff like that could really, really make a strong impact. Really, really good quad. Very well put together here, Jeff. And a bit and a sample from their different albums. I believe each one of their albums. So yeah, a really, really good sampling of songs here, man. So, just checking my notes here before I bounce. Ari, Evelyn, Joe, Alan, I've got reactions I gotta hit up for you folks very, very soon in a couple of days. I'll try and see if I can squeeze all of those out before the weekend is through. Hard to say, we'll see. What else do I have coming up, man? I know that I've got a Jimmy Page interview coming up. And I believe that's from Michael. Michael's a new patron. And Evelyn's got a Robert Plant quad, I believe it is. I'm just kind of going through the Led Zeppelin factor in my mind here. And there's something else Led Zeppelin coming up, but I can't recall what it is. I think actually it's I think it's a bootleg from Susan. I'm just going off the top of my head here, but that's pretty much the Led Zeppelin factor. And then, of course, I've got a variety of other things coming up as well. So that is my rundown probably for the next probably week and a half. I'm just kind of giving you off the top of my head what I'm looking at. Anyways, this was excellent, man. I would definitely look at doing more free. One thing that I haven't done where Paul Rogers is concerned is Bad Company. I've done a little bit more free, and of course I've done the Firm concert with Jimmy Page. So I've done a little bit of each part, but I would say the biggest part of Paul's success being Bad Company, I haven't done. I think I've only done one quad, but I know that they had a really big boom of success with Bad Company, so I've yet to really tap into that part of his career, and probably the biggest and more successful part of his career. I don't know, arguably or what have you. Anyways, that is what I'm looking forward to doing one day. So send some Bad Company my way, man. All right, so I gotta bounce, y'all. Thanks very much for joining me. Hope you enjoyed this. Always nice checking out Paul Rogers, man, listening to his fantastic vocals. I credit him as being one of the best rock singers ever. And he's definitely in my top five for sure. Anyways, you guys have yourselves a good one. Take care. And next time you see me, you'll see me tomorrow. And I believe that will be Aries Reaction. So I'll see you tomorrow. Peace.